When we're talking about perimeter, I like to think of it as a path going around. If I want to walk around a square block or around a circular stadium, how many steps do I have to walk? How much distance do I ultimately cover going around this thing? When I want the area for that same shape, I'm not just looking at the surrounding, I'm looking at a two-dimensional surface. Say I want to cover a rectangular paper with stickers, or the top surface of a round cookie with sprinkles or chocolate chips. How many do I need? How much space do I actually have to cover? With volume, we're finally talking about three-dimensional internal space. If I have a beach ball, how much air can I blow inside? If I have a rectangular cooler, how much water or ice can it hold? Even though we didn't use any boring Google definitions, can you see it? Can you picture it? Can you imagine yourself walking around a stadium, covering a paper with stickers, filling a cooler with ice and water? If the answer is yes, then you're ready for some math. Don't worry about writing down all the equations because I have a mini cheat sheet for you on my website. Just go to layerforsci.com/MCATmath, scroll down to the geometry video, and you'll find the cheat sheet with all of the equations we're about to discuss. Again, that's layerforsci.com/MCATmath, or click the link in the description below. When you look at a rectangle, recognize that it comes from the word for right and angle. A rectangle has four right angles. And if you're thinking about a square, that's just a very specific type of rectangle where the top and the bottom are the same length as the two sides. But let's hold off on that. If this rectangle is a neighborhood block, what is the perimeter? Well, how long will it take you to walk around? Let's say your house is right here on the corner. For you to walk around the block, you may start by walking the long side. Then you take a turn so that you can go down the short side. You take another turn so that you can walk back on the long side, walk back up the short side to get back to your house. How much did you walk? If we call the long side the length and the short side the width, then the total amount of steps that you've taken, or the total distance you've covered, is length 1. Plus width 1, length 2, plus width 2. Now length 1 and 2 and widths 1 and 2 are each the same. So we can combine the equation so that we have 2 times the length plus 2 times the width. And that is equal to the perimeter of a rectangle. If the equation makes sense, don't just memorize it. Ask yourself, what did this perimeter mean? And do I understand how I was able to combine these numbers? To find the area of a rectangle, for example, if I want to cover the top of a paper with stickers, how do I know how much to put? Forget the equation for a second. First, I'm going to need enough stickers to cover the bottom. And then I'm going to have to repeat this pattern of stickers all the way to the top. I need to figure out how many stickers it took to cover the length from one side to the other, and then how many times I had to repeat that going all the way up, which is the width. That means I had to use the length times the width to find the total area, giving me the equation length times width, or A times B, or whatever number you had for the one times whatever number you had for the other. You can think about volume in a very similar way, except that volume means I have something three-dimensional. So instead of a rectangular piece of paper, I might have a rectangular-shaped cooler, which the front of it is very similar to what we saw for area, but then, in addition to the length, which we have going across the bottom, and the width that we have over here, we also have a third dimension. If length is in the x direction and width, in this case, in the y direction, we need something going into the plane of the page into the z direction, like that. And what I want you to imagine here is that this is three-dimensional, where the entire inside can be filled with
volume of anything. And just like with area, if we want to know how much of that thing we can fill, not only do we want to fill the length and then figure out how many times length to get us to the top, we also need to know the depth. How much can I put behind that first layer? So let's say I stack up a bunch of ice cubes that are shaped like Legos, so they're not toppling over. How many of these Lego walls can I have? So I have another wall behind it, and another one behind it, so that I ultimately get a fully stocked three-dimensional cup filled with ice. The letters that you may have memorized for this are going to be slightly different, because the length that we have shown here is technically still the length, but what we call the depth earlier is sometimes called the width, and what we called the width earlier, they're now calling height. Between you and me, A, B, C, side 1, 2, 3. But if you have to memorize it, then the technical equation of volume for a rectangle, although this would be called something else now that I think about it, is length times width times height. Earlier we mentioned that a square is simply a rectangle where the length and the width are the same. So let me show you how you would adjust the equations for a square. Let's put it here in the corner. If 2 times length and 2 times width gave us the perimeter, and the length and the width are technically a side of a square, where each side is the same, so we'd have side 1, side 2, side 3, and side 4. The equation for that would be 2 times the sides that are length, 2 times the sides that are width, or simply 4 times the side. So the perimeter would be 4s, or 4l, 4w, 4 of whatever that number is. For the area, if we had length times width for a rectangle, and the length and width are the same for a square, then once again, if we call the length s and the width s, then it's really just s times s, or s squared for area. And I hope you can see the pattern and recognize where we're going with this for volume. Because if I have a square, and then I turn that into a cube, which is a three-dimensional square, the equation should be length, width, and height. So s times s times s is s cubed. And hey, isn't this thing called a cube? S cubed is the volume of a cube. Are you with me so far? If yes, be sure to hit that like button, subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, and hit the bell icon to be notified of any new videos as soon as they go live. I hope you have a good understanding now of the basics. Let's see if we can take this idea and move on to a more complicated shape, the triangle. Back in high school, I used to struggle with triangles until I noticed something interesting. Triangles obviously come in many shapes and sizes, but they're defined by a triangle. A rectangle is 4, a triangle is 3 angles, and there's all different types that we're not going to go into now. But what I want you to recognize, and this is what made the difference for me, is that if I take a rectangle, or a square, and I cut it in half at the diagonal, I make 2 triangles. Now the type of rectangle will determine the type of triangle, and sometimes you can't find a triangle by cutting a rectangle in half. But maybe if we squish that rectangle a little bit to get a parallelogram, the same thing still applies. Now we got a wacky triangle. I want you to remember this when we get into some of the equations. We'll start simple with a perimeter, remembering that if it's just the distance around, then all I do to calculate the perimeter of a triangle is take the side 1, take the side 2, and take the side 3. You can call these sides whatever you want. You can call them A, B, C, as long as you add all 3 together. So we'll call this equation A plus B plus C. The area of a triangle can be confusing, and this is where the cut a rectangle in half trick really comes into play. If we look at this rectangle, and remember that to calculate the area, we took the length and we multiplied it by the width. Wouldn't it make sense that if I cut the rectangle in half, then the area would just be half of what I calculated? And that's exactly how you find the area of a triangle, but instead of calling this the length, they're calling it the base, the bottom of the triangle, and instead of calling this the width, they're calling it the height. they want different letters, we'll give them different letters, so long as we understand where they're going with it. And so, to calculate the area of the triangle, all we do is find the base, find the height, and the way you do that is find the height to the tallest peak, and then you just take half of that. 1/2 times base times height. The circle is a shape that you're probably very familiar with, but probably also scared of the math. I promise to try to make it easier, but the math is still tricky. Starting with a perimeter, where we just walk around, it's not as easy as a square or a triangle where we say here's one length, here's another, because if we pick a point on the circle, and then we start walking, we walk and walk and walk and walk and walk until we get back to the starting point. So if you can't measure sides, imagine that this is not walking, but this is a string that we wrapped around the circle. Then we take this string and unwrap it. Here's the starting point, here's the end point, find the exact distance from start to finish, and that's your perimeter. Which is very nice, but you're not going to start taking steps on the MCAT, and you definitely can't hold a string up to your computer screen. Instead, you have to memorize the equation 2 pi r. If this looks scary, I want to show you a trick. I want you to imagine that you just purchased a pie. Pick your favorite flavor. I love apple. Imagine this is an apple pie, and it came in a square box. If we try to measure the perimeter of the square, assuming that this distance has a unit of 1, then the square would be side 1, side 2, side 3, side 4. They're all 1, which is 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1. That equals to 4. But the pie is not square. It's round. And so instead of having a total measurement of 4, we have to cut off the corners and kind of round them out a little. So we cut off the corners. And now, it's easier to imagine that what used to be a total perimeter of 4 is now slightly less than 4. Let's say 3 and change. And that 3-something is actually a very special number called, well, pi. If you punch pi into a calculator, you'll get a number of 3.14159635, and it keeps going. But between you and me, pi for the MCAT is not only 3.14, but you can probably get away with thinking something slightly greater than 3. Where did the rest of that go? Well, we cut off the corners, otherwise it would have been 4. This is how I think of pi. Okay, so going back to the equation. What if this square, or the box holding the pie, doesn't have a length of 1? What if it has a length of 2 or 3 or 4? All we do is take this number, where each side is 1, and multiply it by what it really is. Which means that to find the perimeter of a circle, you would go with the number times pi. Well, what is that number? The part that is the longest would be the middle. That is called the diameter. So you take any part of a circle from one end to the other, the longest part is the diameter, or d. And so we would imagine that number times pi is really just pi d, pi times diameter. And that's where we would like to stop. But no, mathematicians had to make it more complicated, and they said, instead of finding the diameter, just find that point in the middle and draw a ray all the way out to the end. That is half your diameter, or your radius r, and that is how we're going to measure it. But we already determined that we need the whole diameter, so instead of saying diameter, they're saying no, no, no. One diameter is equal to 2 times the radius. And so to complicate matters, the final equation to memorize is 2 times pi times your radius, which 2 in radius is really just the diameter. Don't just memorize it, try to understand what the heck just happened here, and therefore to understand how we got the equation of 2 pi r. And that was only the perimeter. Now, if we want to find the area, for example, putting toppings onto a cookie, what is the total space that I can cover? And more importantly, how do I calculate that? Remember that with the square, the way we found the area was finding some measure of the distance and then squaring it. We'll just call it D. So we're going to use some version of that equation, but we can't simply take distance, D, because D is actually diameter. With circles, they like to use radius. So we'll take the radius and we'll square it. The problem is the radius only gives me a measure from the middle to the end. So if I square it, this is what I'm getting. In order to get the entire area of the circle, meaning I want the 3 additional quarters, but I also want to round it so that I'm not getting that excess, the corners that stick out. The way I do that is I just stick in a pi. Pi times radius squared is how we get the area of a circle. And last but not least, the volume of a 3-dimensional circle, which is actually called a sphere. And for this is where the logical explanation kind of takes a backseat as we bow in defeat to calculus, which I will admit I enjoyably suffered through for 3 semesters. Don't ask me why. To come up with this equation, the volume of a sphere is 4 over 3 pi r cubed. So instead of explaining to you where that comes from, because it's beyond the scope of this simple video, let's break it down in a way that kind of sort of makes it make sense, enough that you can memorize and apply. So here's how I think of it. 4 is the number that I would expect if I had a square, right? We saw that to find pi, we had 4, we trimmed the corners, and so we got that down to 3.14 for pi. The pi symbol tells us that it's round. R is the length from the middle of the sphere to the edge, and cubed is how we know that it's 3-dimensional. Now, in calculus, these 2 threes are actually connected, so just know that if we're cubing here, we gotta throw the 3 in there as well, just because that's the equation. Eesh! So again, 4 over 3, we want to adjust for that circle, pi because it's round, r for the radius, cube because it's 3-dimensional, to give us 4 over 3 pi r cubed. So other than this last one, which is kind of tricky, do you see how thinking logically makes the memorization of these equations more doable and maybe even easier to memorize? But don't worry about copying these all down, because I have it all drawn and written out for you on the mini geometry cheat sheet, which you can find on my website, linked below, or by going to layerforsci.com/mcatmath. Scroll down for the geometry video and mini cheat sheet, but on that page you'll also find my entire MCAT Math Without a Calculator video series, the MCAT Math Practice Quiz, and the full MCAT Math cheat sheet. The link again is layerforsci.com/mcatmath.